Dana Show.
Here's how I look at things. And my husband says I have the worst attitude ever on this stuff. I said, you know what? Just expect that you're going to get disappointed by somebody. People got to realize that this is about business of the country, not friends of the country. I don't care if someone's nice. What do you get me in terms of reduced taxpayer dollars going to foreign nations over foreign conflicts? What do you get me in terms of a secure border? What do you get me in keeping your government Uncle Sam hands out of my pockets?
The Dana Show.
Regarding this fitness for office of the president, Americans have been speaking out about the president's mental acuity and the double standards within his Justice Department. On Thursday, as you know, the special counsel confirmed that President Biden mishandled classified materials in a way that presented serious risk to national security. He broke the law, but he's not going to be charged. Why is that? Well, special counsel said that it decided not to indict the president in part because there are significant limitations on his memory, and a jury wouldn't convict him because he would be presented as, quote, an elderly man with a poor memory. That did not inspire confidence among the American people. It's of great concern to us. Ultimately, they're indicting, remember now, the DOJ is indicting one president with politically motivated charges, and they are now carrying the water for another amid very similar allegations. A man too incapable of being held accountable for mishandling classified information is certainly unfit for the Oval Office. And everyone in this room, if you just ask yourself that question, you will come to the same conclusion.
So a lot of stuff happening. We got they're actually going to have an on-time press briefing. Is that correct? It's actually going to be on time here at some point, because usually it's supposed to be in the afternoon.
Keeping my fingers crossed.
When we're on air. And then it's like kind of been like at whatever time they feel like it. So welcome to the show. Dana Lash here with you. You can listen coast to coast. Make sure you sign up for that newsletter, because a lot of stuff goes out, especially when it's like really crazy busy. Like, you know, you have the Mayorkas impeachment, although whether or not anything happens from that remains to be seen, because it's I mean, you have the Senate. You know what I mean? You're not going to be able to get past the Senate. The Senate has to prosecute it, and the House can kick stuff over. But without being able to have that support in the Senate, I mean, I hate to tell you, but it's just really not going to go anywhere. But they did it, though. And now Democrats can have that on their conscience. And we're going to dive into all of that. We also have the election in New York, that special election for George Santos's seat. Maybe the New York Republicans should have spent time not arguing with Texas voters about Congressional District 26. Maybe they should have, I don't know, paid attention to their seat in New York, and they would have kept their ass instead of trying to buy a seat in the 26th Congressional District for one of their Nepo baby friends. Just saying, you know, I mean, I called it or not, right? I mean, good grief. So we got a lot to hit, but that was Mike Johnson, Speaker Johnson, yesterday. And that was after a pretty historic the vote yesterday. I think that was it's, you know, finally it happened, but it was a long time coming, the impeachment of Mayorkas. And so these House Republicans, I mean, they finally did the right thing. And that's not going to, like I said, it's not going to lead to his removal, though. It's not going to lead to his removal. But I do think that it's good that Republicans did it. I mean, you got such a super thin majority in the House. And I do think it is to Johnson's credit that he was able to shepherd this through. Now, you know, the trial's held in the Senate. But now people are trying to, I was looking at this piece, let me pull this up to you. This is what I was reading this morning. This is from CBS. And it said, the House impeached Alejandro Mayorkas. But then they're getting into some of the rules that there are, some of the tricks that they're trying to play in the Senate so that they can just dismiss the charges entirely. Now they're saying, obviously, you know, the vote doesn't remove him from office, since impeachment is just the first step. But they said now it heads to the Senate and they have sole control over this. And so they get to make the ultimate determination. And so whether or not this, you know, it happens like that, well, it remains to be seen. But still, you know, it's pretty big. It's good that they did it. I feel like voters needed something. You know what I mean? I feel like voters deserved something, especially after the mess that we've seen at the border. And that was, you know, obviously this him not being able to do his job was one of the reasons why. So the Senate rules, this is what they're saying. The Senate, and this is what Democrats are trying to do. They're saying that the rules, once the chamber gets the House votes and then they send over the articles of impeachment, and then the Senate goes from there on the articles of impeachment. And they're saying that when the House gets, after the House sends those, the majority could vote to reinterpret the rules that they're supposed to follow as it pertains to the impeachment process or the trial, et cetera. You know, they could vote to change the rules, which I feel like that would make a lot of people mad if they did something like that. But they're saying that the Senate rules, you know, they could vote to change these rules and then what, just dismiss them entirely? They said they have options to do it. They got some options to change it. And so that's what they're looking at. So this is going to be, I think, and Democrats should probably be careful with kind of, you know, refashioning certain rules on things, because that I don't think is going to work out too well for them going into an election year. Because even Democrats see how unbelievably bad this has been, Mayorkas has been on this issue, amongst many other things. So this has been the latest of it. But they said that the Democrats, you know, they're considering, you know, maybe changing some of these rules. They're considering it. Yeah. Well, we're going to talk more about that. Also, this New York special election. So like I said, you had George Santos, the seat, and George Santos got into some trouble. And he, I know that they're still, they have criminal charges against him. This was the special election in New York. And basically, from what I understand, you had kind of a Democrat going up against a Democrat. And a lot of people are trying to interpret these special elections that we've seen. They're trying to interpret how this is going to play out for November. Now, I will say this. I think that New York's GOP is kind of a mess. I think it's a mess because this was a district that, and I'm looking at some of my notes on this. This was a district. It was, I think, what was it? Plus 7 Democrat, I think. And I think when Santos won it, I think he ended up getting, I think he won it by 2. I think that was the margin that he won it by, And so it's a competitive seat. It doesn't mean necessarily that it's a solid blue seat. Yeah, Santos won the district plus 2. Zeldin won the district plus 10 when he was running for governor in 2022. Democrats were overperforming, and it looked, I mean, when they ran a candidate that a lot of people said was essentially just a Democrat, but it was Queens, New York's third district. And it was in 2022, it was a plus 4 district. And now, I mean, going by the way everybody voted, you could say that it's a plus 24. And it was this Matsi Pilip and Tom Suozzi who ran, a Democrat. The Republican was considered to be, again, basically a Democrat. It was kind of like a Scosa Fava part 2 thing. But a lot of people are looking at this race saying, well, is this race, what is this forecast for November? And you got to be careful with a lot of these. We got to be careful with some of the races. You have to look at the way that Republicans handled it. You have to look at the get out the vote effort, as opposed to just strictly looking at the number of people or how people voted, etc. Because getting out the vote is supremely important. And apparently New York Republicans fell flat on their backsides on this, which is kind of typical for Republicans, period. And now it's not just New York. I mean, you have there are a number of special elections that have been held at this point that Republicans have just not done a singular damn thing on. And the other thing that this forecast too, and looking at pull this up and looking at some of the data coming out of this district. So the suburban voters, and they're mostly college educated white voters, Republicans are really hurting with them. You are not so rich in guaranteed wins that you can give up on a demographic, whether it's a minority demographic, whether it's female, whatever it is, you can't just give up on a demographic. And in looking at this third congressional district, this was a lot of college educated white people, and Republicans were hurting with them, particularly these New York Republicans. I don't know. This is like the third time this has popped up. This also popped up in that special election in Florida that was a very competitive seat and that DeSantis had won plus 5. And it's like a plus 14 district. DeSantis took it plus 5 and it ended up being flipped to a Democrat. And that was a congressional seat in Florida. And again, the candidate was pretty weak, but that's kind of a problem with running weak candidates. There's a lot of stuff that's playing in here. And I think that it's maybe enough now at this point that Republicans seriously need to have a discussion about how they're reaching out to people and who they're reaching out to. And I honestly think that some of it is because some of the stuff that's coming out of the Republican Party is weird as hell. Like, I'm not kidding you. I read an editorial the other day talking about how the hand signs in Taylor Swift's multi-million dollar Super Bowl box were satanic. I mean, forget the fact that, you know, you got, I mean, there's probably a lot of other things that you could have pointed. I think that was just like too, there's certain things that certain Republicans go all in on that are so weird to me. And they freak out over, and then they run away people that they need to build a coalition. This is what a coalition is. You're not going to be able to have a purity test with a coalition because you're never going to be able to convince enough people that you need to win an elected seat to think exactly like you do, to live exactly like you do, to talk exactly like you do, to eat exactly what you eat, to live exactly like you live. You're never going to be able to convince people to do that. That's why you got to focus on the 80-20. People have got to be smart on this. But I think a lot of people are interested, honestly, and rubbing their own egos than they are actually building a coalition, because they look at it as I have to compromise on something. And if I'm having to compromise on something, that means there's less of me, when it's not a compromise because you're not giving up a principle. You're just choosing to focus on the 80% that's going to allow you to take the seat, because you're not even going to be able to have a chance to worry about the 20% if you can't get your foot in the door on the 80. And I feel like that's kind of one of the things that's playing in here. And Republicans are just not having, they're not handling this. They're not dealing with this issue. And the get out the vote effort sucks. It is so bad. I'm telling you, those people, they needed to not worry about what Texas was doing, and they needed to have focused on the seat. So we're going to talk about this, because this seat flipped back to Democrats. I'm not going to dive into like New York and all this, but there is, I think, enough to, If it doesn't serve a warning, it's at least enough to beg the question, meaning presuming the premise is true, so the conclusion is this. I think there's enough there. So we have to discuss this, because now Pilla, she seemed like a strong candidate. She was moderate on a lot of stuff. Some people were saying that she was actually a Democrat. But this was the woman who was the Ethiopian Israeli mother of seven, and she was a former IDF paratrooper. But in Nassau County was 80% of that district. She had a 4-point lead going into this. And people are saying, oh, well, there was a heavy snowstorm. I don't believe that, because they're used to dealing with that stuff on like this. I think a lot of it was get out the vote. We're going to, like, again, we're going to talk about it, because there's a lot to discuss with this. And Republicans got to get with it. They really do. As we move, because we got a lot of stuff to hit. We got headlines on the way as well. Our partners committing to a healthier diet this year seemed like a straightforward resolution, but actually doing it, that's way more challenging. Better nutrition is a key to health and longevity. So this year, get into a new healthy habit with Field of Greens. Field of Greens is nutrition the way nature intended it. Each superfruit and vegetable in Field of Greens was doctor selected to support vital organs such as the heart, lungs, and kidneys, as well as promoting a healthy metabolism for sustaining energy and weight management. Field of Greens is an organic superfood rich in antioxidants, fiber, and prebiotics formulated to enhance overall well-being. People taking Field of Greens have noticed more energy throughout the day, healthier looking skin, and improved digestion. You'll notice better health or your money back. If you resolve to get healthier in 24, it starts with Field of Greens. Visit fieldofgreens.com and use promo code Dana to get 15% off your first order and free rush shipping. That's promo code Dana at fieldofgreens.com.
And now, all of the news you would probably miss. It's time for Dana's Quick Five.
So first up, prices rose more than expected in January, and inflation isn't going away. But wait a minute. Whoa. I thought that that wasn't a thing that we had to worry about. Yeah, it was just transitory. And I mean, I'm going back. I'm literally looking through my bookmarks because I have a whole bunch of things that say Yellen. I have a whole online bookmarking system. I literally have a whole thing of Yellen. And I'm going through and I'm my goodness, what is this? In December, the first week of December, she was downplaying fears of inflation or permanence. I mean, literally everything that she spoke at, she was downplaying this. Okay.
Not to mention Jerome Powell talking about cutting rates back in December. He said he was going to do it this year. So far, they're not able to do it.
Is hot inflation becoming a phrase? Because this is the fifth time I've seen this in a headline. Dow tumbles 500 points, posts worst day since March 23rd after hot inflation report. I've seen hot inflation report five times. I'm not kidding you. I have CNBC. I have Wall Street Journal, Axios. There was another one. I keep seeing hot inflation report. No, but it's true because it's bad. Clearly you guys understand, you know, butter went up again. You know that, right? It was like near $7. I promise you, to you, maybe you're like, Dana, 20 something cents isn't a lot. It is when you're obsessing over certain things and you're watching the prices of them. Anyway, so stocks dropped after hotter than expected inflation data for January spiked Treasury yields, raised doubts that the Feds would be able to cut rates several times this year. And that was a key part of the bull case for the equity market. The Dow lost 524.63 points. It's 1.35%. It's just a hot mess. Everything's a hot mess. Surging restaurant prices are also making dining out a luxury. So if you are wanting to, like, you know, a lot of people talking about eating out, you know, Valentine's Day, it is cheaper for people to eat at home instead of dining out, unless you're actually trying to make healthy food, because the cost of, like, whole foods, healthy foods is incredibly expensive. A lot. Groceries are up almost, I think it's actually up over 1.5% year over year. Food consumed at restaurants, though, it's up 5%. You got to think about the energy, all the stuff used to get everything there as well. The Air Force has announced a major shakeup in what some say might be a prep in any kind of conflict with China. This Space Force has listed changes as well, including a futures command. So the U.S. Air Force is changing the way it deploys forces as part of the sweeping overhaul. We have a lot more on the way. Stick with us.
Looking for the drive-through version of The Dana Show? Check out the best highlights from every show and Dana's Absurd Truth podcast, posted daily from The Dana Show.
House Republicans are still at it right now, siding with Donald Trump, Vladimir Putin, and Tehran against our defense, industrial base, against NATO, against Ukraine, against our interests in the Indo-Pacific.
See, you guys don't understand. If you want the border to be secured, you love you some Putin. That's all there is to it. Rootin' tootin' Putin, you must love him. If you think the border should be secured, man, you love big bad Vlad. That's what they're saying. That's literally what they're saying. That was, what's her face? KJP, the Nordstrom pipeline. Sidebar. I know I've said this before, but you know how amazing that would be? Just like, you know, could... Okay, I'm going to come back. Just wait. Just indulge me for a hot second. Because that's the way we're describing everything now. It's all hot. Hot inflation report. Hot inflation. Hot everything. Can you imagine, like, what we would save? I'm just thinking, like, on export-import tax, having, like, a pipeline where you could just jettison stuff through it, like the channel between England and France. You know, just jettison stuff from, like, Europe over here to the United States. I'm just, like, wondering, like, would that take the price down on leather goods? Like, if you wanted to get skilled Italian artisans, like, if you're, you know, you want, like, a pair of loafers or something like that, and you want some nice Italian leather, you know what I'm saying? Not the stuff that's produced in Prado by Chinese-owned factories and illegal immigrant Chinese workers, but, like, actual Italian craftsmen. You know, you could just, like, chuck those through the channel between Europe and the United States, like a Nordstrom pipeline. I'm just wondering what that does to the tax situation. I bet it knocks, like, 19% off, 20% off the price. Yeah. Am I the only person who thinks like this, especially right as I'm going to bed? No? Okay. See, this is why I can't have any more than one cup of that Black Rifle coffee a day, because I am on 11 normally anyway. So let's get back to this, our KJP point. Although I could spend an hour.
Did she say Vladimir Putin's name? Hold on. I just wanted to hear.
Wait, did you catch something?
I thought I heard something. I don't know.
Siding with Donald Trump, Vladimir Putin, and...
Did she say Vladimir? I think
Vladimir?
She said Vladimir.
Vladimir. Where? Vladimir. What? I don't know.
Siding with Donald Trump, Vladimir Putin.
Yeah, that's right. Vladimir Putin. Maybe take the rocks out of your mouth.
It's her, Vladimir Biden, Putin. And Kamala.
Is everyone drunk in that administration? Jiminy Christmas. You got President Daddy Showers McSniff's kids, mumble mouth gravelly talk, and now you've got her. What in the world? Vladimir Putin. So, that's what they're pushing. I'm so tight. By the look, Trump is not calling the shots on this. You know what? There's a real, some of you can get mad at me, but there's a real easy way to shut that up. You want to know how to do it? Remind KJP that Trump actually was agreeing with Democrats back in 2018 and almost granted Paul Ryan's amnesty bill. He pushed that bill ahead of a different border bill. Oh, yeah. Go back and look. So what are they talking about? He's not calling the shots on this. Like, now he was supporting like H.R. 2 and that now. And that's fine. You know, I'm all about bringing people, you know, bringing that tugboat into shore. I'm all fine with that. But let's be real about this. They keep trying to make this about Trump because that's literally the only way that they can try to get a leg up on anything. They are terrified to acknowledge that people are genuinely concerned and have legitimate concerns about everything coming in at the border. So that's why they want to reframe the discussion as that. But think about this. You wanting a stronger border and not wanting this bill, you not wanting to spend, how much was it, like $19 billion or something that they were sending to Ukraine out of this? Not wanting to spend more billions of our tax dollars. Sending
$61 billion.
Oh, wait, that's right. It was $95 billion bills. $61 billion of the $95 billion was going to go to Ukraine. Right. The $9 billion was going to Gaza. Mm-hmm. You know, the innocent terrorist government of Gaza. We didn't know that throwing rockets and, like, taking paragliders and murdering people and baking babies in ovens was bad. That's Gaza's defense. That's the Gazan government's, Hamas's defense. Vote for terrorists, you're a terrorist. So 9 billion, it was 9.1 billion that was going towards Gaza. So if you don't support all of that, then you love yourself some Putin. I'm just done with the, I'm done with that. Like, where are Republicans on this stupid messaging? Where are they at on this? You know what I would do? I would have, first off, I wouldn't run for elected office people keep going, would you go for this position? Would you go for someone, they were trying to push it on Twitter. You should be RNC chair. No. It will be a bloodbath. You know, like firing people speaking. Sure. It'll be a bloodbath because I would fire everyone. I would regrade everybody and I would stop all the floral deliveries, everything. You're lucky if you get a half of a damn Twizzler at a meeting. You know, and is found in somebody's couch. So you'd be lucky to get that. Anyway, so I would have, if I were in elected office, first off, if I had been, you know, tortured myself enough to run for office, if I had been, I would leak that, oh, Republicans are going to have like a big press conference. Oh, we're going to have a big, we're going to be something big. I would just trick the press. The press love thinking that there's going to be some kind of drama. And I wouldn't tell everybody. I'd keep it like kitchen cabinet small, right? Like Reagan at his kitchen cabinet. I'd keep it kitchen cabinet small. Only those who need to know are going to know. And I would like really stage the thing too, right? You know, go in that rotunda. You stage your shot. Maybe bring in some red velvet drapes like on a pole. You can get them at like a Joann Fabrics, right? Go into Joann's. Get you a pole. Put them drapes up there. Put some American flags up there. And then the press is thinking, wow, what's going to happen here? It's like a very fancy presser. Happening here, you know, maybe have a little sign made for the podium, Republicans speak 2024, put it up there, and then we'd come out, and I think I would roll out a little television. You know how when you were a kid and in class and whenever that TV on the roller cart came out, you knew it was going to be a good day? I think I'd roll one of those out too, and I'd play what KJP just said, and that's how I'd start the presser. And then my response immediately after that would be, is she burp? Hi. And then I would dive into, it's legitimate concern at the border. And by the way, not wanting to fund Ukraine doesn't mean you like Putin. That doesn't even make any sense. Like Putin's not, it's you. It's Russia, the way that the War Inc. talks about it, they act like Russia is this big, giant, absolutely super powerful entity that cannot be defeated. And yet they couldn't push through Ukraine. For every way they tried, they couldn't do it. You know, pushing against all of this money going away from establishing our security somehow means you're siding with Russia. It doesn't make sense. I would just get up and have a press conference and make fun of her. Be like, let's see, what else are we going to, so if we don't want to send money to the terrorists in Hamas, are we siding with Russia? Like, so if you don't get your way every single time, you're siding with Russia? This is what Republicans should be doing. You're siding with Russia because you're mad that we want to spend money on border security. So wanting to spend money on border security means siding with Russia. You're not supposed to inhale the exhaust that comes out of the Nord Stream pipeline, KJP. Golly. It's just asinine. Oh, my gosh. But that's how they're trying to spin. I don't think that's actually going to work. As long as Republicans keep highlighting the hot mess at the border, honestly, I think that that's going to be enough. But they're going to get distracted. They're going to get distracted, and they're going to start flipping out over the RNC stuff and everything. I mean, just the stupidest stuff ever. I don't know. I can't. I wanted to touch real quickly, go back to this special election in New York. If you put up a Democrat against a Democrat, and the Democrat's running as a Republican and they're running up against a Democrat, you know the Democrat's going to win, right? That identifies as a Democrat. That's one of the reasons why I'm a little hesitant to say that this special election completely, entirely is a, you know, canary in the coal mine for 2024. I think the special election in Florida already was that. And I think that there's a couple of other things that have already, the Wisconsin court fight, I think, and then what happened in Virginia, I think those already have sort of signaled what Republicans need to do that they still haven't done yet. But at the same time, why couldn't you have portrayed this Democrat running as a Republican, as a moderate Republican, and use that to attract the non-Trump base that would consider voting Republican in this race? I mean, you had George Santos win this. George Santos, he's a man who gets Botox. He's I met him. He's nice. We had him. I'll tell you about George Santos, because he did that video where he was trying to get, he didn't exactly know exact what he was jumping into, but he was talking about that congressional race in Texas, 26, where you got somebody who literally just moved in. It's a common, I don't want to name names because I'm still friends with them, but at the same time, this is the business of the country, not friends, show business, not show friends. But you have literally somebody who just moved from New York, the younger dude in the race, whose dad father-in-law is trying to buy him the seat. The father-in-law created this pack, filled it six figures. The father-in-law commentator kind of already got in trouble over political donations. That was a big thing a while ago. But it's an absolute fact that they're trying to buy the seat, like completely. They've been buying all these Lincoln dinners and all this other stuff. And I mean, it's like really, really incestuous nepotism. It's bad. And the guy's never worked in the private sector. And I'm not exaggerating, because Oppo researchers have looked. He's never worked in the private sector. He used to live in the Trump Tower when he was in New York. He lived in the Trump Tower for a long time. Didn't work in the private sector. He did a digital startup that was financed by the father-in-law, and then decided, they waited and saw the seat open up, and then decided to move to Texas and then try to run for the seat. And so Santos made this video where he was commenting on one of the candidates in the race, who's my mayor, John Huffman. And I was mad because I'm like, New York, he's kind of on the periphery. He's not really part of it, but he's on the periphery of this group of New York Republicans that came up recently. They think that conservatism is what they define it as, which is big government. They're moderate, actual Republicans. They're not actually conservatives. They're moderates. And they think that if they just, you know, go in and show their ass, you know, a couple of times publicly, that that's going to be enough to woo voters, you know, just the simple things in life. And they decided to, like, make him a sacrificial lamb, so to speak. And they didn't really come out. Some of the stuff that they were lobbing at Santos was just, I thought was petty. Some of it, you know, fine, investigate it. I just think it's weird that Gold Bar Bob can stay there, and then, but they have to make an example out of Santos. And this is where Republicans get stupid, because the Republicans in New York got pushed around, and they didn't back him up. I mean, for all the talk about being as tough as they are, they got pushed down to the ground and they're facing the dirt. These people are not, they talk a big game on Twitter. And that's one of the things you got to realize. A lot of these people who talk big games on Twitter, Twitter doesn't move nothing. This social media stuff doesn't move the needle one bit. All the stupid conferences and the big conservative events don't move the needle one bit. So they didn't back him. They ended up losing this seat. So anyway, Santos had made this video, and God love him, we kind of ambushed him. I know a lot of people are going to take exception. They think he's a crook or think he's this. But he was a good sport, because we ambushed him at a dinner with Huffman. I'm like, let's come to dinner and drinks. I'm not going to tell them that we're going to have Huffman there too. Because I'm like, yeah, we're not going to do this in with my mayor. But it went out. He was very nice, and he apologized profusely, and he was very nice. They got a picture, and he was, you know, he gets it. And he was a good sport about it. And he could have been petty and snotty, and he wasn't. He understands politics. You can talk about, look, Santos has his issues. You can sit here and talk about him six ways to Sunday, but he gets the game. He gets politics, and he gets that it's about the voter. And I think that's what made him at odds with this New York group, because they don't. They think it's about them. They don't think it's about the voter. This is a disease that is expanding within the GOP right now. It's about the voter. It's not about your personality. It's not about whatever politician you love. It's about the voter. What are you doing for the voter? Voter's all that matters. Everybody else is noise. What are you doing for the voter? Santos gets it. I can't believe I'm saying this. He had a more conservative record than somebody like John Kennedy out of Louisiana, who's kind of moderate. Santos had a ridiculously conservative record. He had a conservative record more so than a lot of what you would consider conservative. I'm not saying that I think he's an angel. I'm just saying, he gets the voter. So for all the faults that people might think he has, he gets the voter. Steve is telling me, we got to go to break. But I wanted to explain that because this, out of everything that I think the New York special election is forecasting, it is forecasting the problem within the GOP, not the electorate. We're going to talk more about that here coming up as we move.
Don't let FOMO get the best of you. Stay in the loop and ahead of the curve by following Dana on Apple, Spotify, or wherever you get your podcasts.
Like sands through the hourglass, so are the days of the United States.
I say many times, especially to the young folks that I mentor, you know, we can think of history as being a relay race. And, of course, there are then those who carried the baton before us, and then they passed the baton to us. And we who are in this room right now currently hold the baton. And I do believe that the ancestors, that the founders, and we are talking about the founding mothers and fathers of our country, by the way, I do believe that they didn't necessarily think that we would end the race, but charged us with a responsibility to do as much and as best as we could while we carry the baton.
I'm not going to lie, I fell asleep with my eyes open. I'm just, what? I just fell asleep. I don't even know what this is. What is she talking about?
I don't know.
I've heard it four times and I don't know.
I literally was just, I zoned out for a second. Every time I hear her, I just go.
Gist of it was, history is a relay race and the baton is in our hands, passed to us by our ancestors.
If you look at the Venn diagram, which I love, those Venn diagrams. So can someone explain to us, while she's out here, you know, clucking over whatever the hell that is, what is this threat situation? Did you guys hear about this? So apparently the House Intelligence Committee says there's a really vague threat out there. They actually made it official. We're going to talk about this coming up. Stick with us. If any parent out there allows their kids unfettered access on social media, you're a bad parent. It's irresponsible, it's reckless, and it's dangerous. Bottom line, you would let your kids hang out, you know, at a bus stop in a drug dealing part of town, would you? Completely unsupervised. You got to look at social media the same way. I also reject the argument that I hear from some folks, and they're always progressives. They get real mad. And they're like, oh, it's easy for you to say. You know, it's, well, why is it easy for me to say? Is there something that sort of, do I have am I better equipped at monitoring my kids than you are? That doesn't make any sense. I don't understand that argument. Monitor your damn kids. Raise your damn kids. That's your job as a parent. It's not the government's job. It's not Daddy Mark Zuckerberg's job. That is the best way to thwart predation, is to be involved and to monitor your kids. Because this is not something that we can trust the government to do. You're going to allow the government to come in and take over the administration of this, the same government that will sooner take your kid away from you for not allowing them to cut off their genitals and quote unquote transition to a different sex. You're going to allow that government to come in and set these requirements, set these expectations, set these regulations. I mean, come on, guys, we gotta look at what we're doing here. Now, yes, absolutely. The, you know, engagement, the censorship of conservatives, that was an algorithmic thing. That I will say, with X, it was an algorithmic thing because it's something that Musk has talked about. They said that there are so many layers that it's taken them years to kind of go through all the code and just clean everything up. With Facebook, oh my gosh, I've been targeted on Facebook so many times. I think it's a lot of their administrators, and that in addition to algorithms. But pointing this out is not a defense of the practice. I'm simply saying I think people need to chill before they rush into a situation that allows a godless government that would take your children away from you for not acknowledging their progressive quote-unquote transitioning to set the parameters for this. That's my whole point. The internet is full of good and bad things, and it's the responsibility of the parents to help their kids navigate it. Blaming third-party services isn't the solution. That's a formula that the left uses. Case in point, after Uvalde, one of the rifles that was used was made by Daniel Defense. Now, they were targeted because their product was murderously used by a dangerous individual with a known record of violence and threats and disturbing behavior. The family that knew, including the reported uncle, that drove the teenager to go buy the rifle after he was previously caught doing drive-by BB gun shootings and swinging around dead cats in bags. The family skirted responsibility, but the company did not. They went after Daniel Defense, the anti-gun lobby. So why was a company responsible for a minor illegally using its illegal product? In 2021, you had a racist murderer drive a Ford SUV through a Christmas parade in Waukesha, killing five and injuring 48 people. Is Ford responsible for those fatalities? This is my point. We have to be very careful. Now, if you, and it requires this in our republic, bring up the evidence and press the charge that, well, Ford, you know, made this easier because they were involved in this, or they changed the algorithms, or they encouraged this predation. That's an entire issue. That's an entirely different issue. And one, I'm all for, I believe in capital punishment for child predators. So you're not going to find an argument for me. I think it should be public and live streamed and raise money for the victims, too. You're not going to find an argument for me. But I'm just saying, we got to be very, very careful with us. And I think some, and I like, look, I like Josh Hawley. I don't agree with everybody on everything. And I hate it that we live in such a tribal, politically tribal time. And this is what happens when you get these leftist grifters in the right. Everything gets so politically tribal that you cannot have one disagreement, especially on a very important issue that deserves the sharpening of iron in discussion, without being accused of hating the person or whatever. I like Josh Hawley. I mean, he comes from my home state. I just think he went too hard on this, and I think that he's moved by the stories that he's hearing from the families. And that it's kind of altering his perspective here a little bit. We have to be very, very careful in giving big government a foothold. Kids have to have boundaries. They have to have parental oversight. They have to have intervention when needed, not free reign on social media. Because government and corporations are poor parents.
The Dana Show.
Here's how I look at things. And my husband says I have the worst attitude ever on this stuff. I said, you know what? Just expect that you're going to get disappointed by somebody. People got to realize that this is about business of the country, not friends of the country. I don't care if someone's nice. What do you get me in terms of reduced taxpayer dollars going to foreign nations over foreign conflicts? What do you get me in terms of a secure border? What do you get me in keeping your government Uncle Sam hands out of my pockets?
The Dana Show.
Is there anything you can say to characterize what this threat is or what country it involves? I mean, should the public be alarmed at this point since he has said this publicly?
I'm not in a position to say anything further today. Like I said, I look forward to the discussion with him. And obviously from there, we will determine how to proceed. But standing here at the podium today, I can't share anything further.
So that seems totally healthy. So this is what's up. First, that's Jake Sullivan, who is being asked about this. And he's with the NSA, National Security Administration. He says he's not in a position to say if the public should be alarmed by this urgent matter regarding a destabilizing foreign military capability. And so I wanted to, this is what came out. This is from the House Intelligence Committee and the chairman, Mike Turner. He's a Republican with GOP oversight as well. He's out of Ohio. He released a statement saying this, quote, "Today, the House Permanent Select Committee on Intelligence has made available to all members of Congress information concerning a serious national security threat. I'm requesting that President Biden classify all information relating to this threat so that Congress, the administration, and our allies can openly discuss the actions necessary to respond to this threat." And so Jake Sullivan was asked, well, I'm not in a position to say if you should be alarmed. What kind of answer is that? Don't you feel like you should... This is okay. I'm going to bring the tugboat to shore, but roll with me for a moment. This is what infuriates me about drama queens that are Democrats. First off, my number one pet peeve, as Steve says, then why the hell say anything? My number one pet peeve are drama queens. I hate, there's only three things I hate. A dude whose name rhymes with Schmannon because he's a traitor to the country. Also, I hate Green Day. And I hate drama queens. Everything else is just a very strong dislike. You know, like ABBA, I appreciate the artistry and I get that they're very smart. And I just am, that's not my bag. Just because it's not my bag doesn't mean I hate it. I just dislike it, right? So hate's a strong word. I hate drama queens. I hate it when there is a drama queen infusion into my politics like this. Because this is a time when you should be super sober-minded, right? Do you remember when 9/11 happened and I was 21 years old and I'm watching, they kept playing that video over and over again. Bush was in a Florida classroom, elementary school kids, like little kids, third and fourth graders. He's reading a book. And that's when one of his top aides walked up to him, whispered in his ear, "Sir, the United States is under attack." And I will say for all so many things that I disagree with Bush on, the way that he handled that after was masterful, because a lot of people would have just been very dramatic about it, I think. And I think those are moments like that that truly test what skills you have. No one ever rises to an occasion. They always fall back on their highest level of training, right? And he, for a moment, his face turned into an eagle and his eyes got real shrewd looking and just real pointed. And then he had a different vibe. After he stayed there on the stage, he didn't freak out, but there was a different vibe. And later on, like 15 years later, they went back and they interviewed the kids in the classroom. And every single one of those kids, black, white, Asian, every single one of them, Democrat, Republican, whatever, every one of them said they didn't realize it at the time, but they were grateful that he maintained his calmness and his composure, because that could have led the nation into hysteria had he not. And they said he made it something we could understand and manage after because of the way he reacted. Now, I mention that because I actually kind of use that as a baseline for everything. And I will say, I know people, I don't know how Rudy Giuliani went from being America's mayor to being like made fun of and stuff. I don't get it. One of the things that he said the week after 9/11, because they said there was at one point where Giuliani was awake for 3 days straight. And he was living on coffee and he was just trying to coordinate. And someone had asked him, how are you able to keep your level head through all this? And he goes, it was my dad. He's like, my dad always told me that the calmest person in the room will always be able to figure their way out of any situation. And I have always remembered that. In fact, that's what I remembered when I was on stage at Parkland. And that was 6 years ago today. We're going to talk about that coming up. That was the first thing that was what I had in my head on stage for that town hall. And so I comparing this with this, Jake Sullivan. Now, I'm not saying that his demeanor is hysterical, but why say anything at all? He could just say, that's something that we're going to circle back with the press on when we have more information to give. You should not want to even give an inkling of hysteria or anything to the general public. It's like, and Tommy Lee Jones said in Men in Black, and I love Tommy Lee Jones. Tommy Lee Jones, his line was, a person is smart. People are stupid. A person can be calm and cool, but you get a bunch of persons together and then people, they feed off each other's hysteria. Why would you even float that as bait? And then, because I am that cynical, and because I, along with all of you, have just, we've lived through an era where the government shut us down, locked down, made everyone stay in their homes, made it, pulled everybody's kids out of school, tried to force jabs onto everybody. Then it made me think, is this a way to manipulate people into pushing for support of this Ukraine supplemental? Think about it. I don't put anything past my government. I'm an American, though. I don't put anything past any government, not just my government. I don't put anything past it. So it made me wonder. I mean, you're talking about national security, and Kane notes, Kane, just go ahead, because Kane's cap's locking right now in Slack. His inside voice is getting really loud.
Yes. First of all the people to say or be in a position to say, on things of national security, it would be Jake Sullivan, our national security advisor.
Correct.
But also, it's kind of nice that right before the authority to spy on us with the FISA amendment, right when that's running out, all of a sudden now there's a national threat. I don't know, false flags and all, but there's an agenda when there needs to be legislation pushed forward, and a lot of times this is the kind of stuff we see.
Yeah. I mean, now I was looking at some of this because the Jakes, so he was saying that it's an urgent matter with regard to a destabilizing foreign military capability. So is that Iran? Is that what they're talking about? I mean, it just seems like there, you can't just float. This is all to manipulate the public. This is all to manipulate the public. That's what this is. And it could be, as Kane said, because of the FISA sunset, that provision with regard to
both. It could literally serve both.
Could be the Ukraine thing, could be both. This is a government that once told us that white supremacy was the greatest threat to the nation. So forgive me if I just don't take them seriously. When someone says something that butt-tastically stupid, because there literally isn't another adjective for it. I had to fashion that one out of the ether. I just can't take them seriously on anything else. Can you? I mean, they looked at you with a straight face and like, well, the greatest threat. I mean, you got BLM burning down churches and stuff. The greatest threat. It's white supremacy. I don't know. I question their ability to actually identify threats. Number one. I question their ability to identify threats. And number two, I do think that this is an absolute issue of, I think right now I'm leaning towards this is them trying to manipulate you, the public. That's what it seems like. Because they don't need to go and make it public if there's an actual threat. Oh, there's a threat, guys. We can't talk about it. We need XYZ to, when have you ever heard that? Oh, we got to be able to talk about this threat. We got to have make a public thing about. And yes, I am questioning Turner on this to an extent. What do you mean? What kind of threat? You have to publicly ask the president to declassify stuff. I mean, y'all know that there's like a whole. Not everything has to be done on social media. Not everything has to be done in front of the cameras. I just feel like if it was a real threat, it would have been done privately. I don't know. And now you have Jake Sullivan saying this. So I don't know. I question absolutely everything, and you should. As I said, 6 years ago today, I had I'm keeping in my thoughts some very good friends of mine who lost their children at Parkland. A week after that, that's when we had that infamous town hall. And I wanted to point something out. And I told everybody this years ago, actually, in the years that followed, because I've covered this story relentlessly, obviously. And this was also stuff that the Marjorie Stoneman Douglas Commission, which was made in the wake of this tragedy to evaluate what went wrong and how to fix it, what they also uncovered. The Florida Sun Sentinel ran a piece talking about how a retired, and I had this story, and I actually had talked to the parents and one of the teachers in this. And I had to protect the teacher's identity. But there was a retired Secret Service agent that had warned Stoneman Douglas, the school, about the security failures. They warned administrators that the school could be vulnerable. They walked in. They were this parent, this retired Secret Service agent, Steve Wexler. He walked through the school with Post-it notes and was able to put them all on students, the backs of students and teachers, etc., so he could showcase just how easy it was to do something like this, how easy it could be for someone to gain access. And he'd said, you know, just imagine these Post-it notes are gunshots. And this was before the tragedy took place. Florida Sun Sentinel has an article that's still available up about it. Marjorie Stoneman Douglas ignored that risk assessment. Everything that was recommended to them to prevent this massacre, they ignored it in the days leading up. They didn't lock the doors. They didn't have an ability to declare a code red. And it was confirmed by other staff. This is all the stuff that was buried by many of the people in the media. They were busy calling me a devil. And I was out here talking to parents and retired Secret Service agents and everything else about all of the things that school could have done beforehand that they refused to do and failed to do. And 6 years on, nothing has changed, except I think they do lock the gates now and maybe lock the doors. But it's tragic. We're going to talk more about this because KJP, she mentioned Parkland yesterday, but you know what they didn't mention? Sutherland Springs and how that was thwarted by a good guy with a gun, a dear friend of mine. We have more on the way as we move toward. Committing to a healthier diet this year seemed like a straightforward resolution, but actually doing it, that's way more challenging. Better nutrition is a key to health and longevity. So this year, get into a new healthy habit with Field of Greens. Field of Greens is nutrition the way nature intended it. Each superfruit and vegetable in Field of Greens was doctor selected to support vital organs such as the heart, lungs, and kidneys, as well as promoting a healthy metabolism for sustaining energy and weight management. Field of Greens is an organic superfood rich in antioxidants, fiber, and prebiotics formulated to enhance overall well-being. People taking Field of Greens have noticed more energy throughout the day, healthier looking skin, and improved digestion. You'll notice better health or your money back. If you resolve to get healthier in 24, it starts with Field of Greens. Visit fieldofgreens.com and use promo code Dana to get 15% off your first order and free rush shipping. That's promo code Dana at fieldofgreens.com.
And now, all of the news you would probably miss. It's time for Dana's Quick Five.
So this was in India. A woman in a hearse on her way to her own cremation came back to life. This 52-year-old woman from Burhanpur, India, was severely burned in a fire in her home. She was taken to the hospital. She returned home. She was in a bad state. She didn't open her eyes. Her family were unable to get her to another hospital. So her husband had actually thought that she had passed because they could get no response from her. They couldn't. So he arranged for her to be taken to cremation in a hearse. And then she literally woke up in it. And the driver had to like pull over and get her out. Oh my gosh, this is crazy. But here's the crazy thing. This hasn't just happened in India. An 82-year-old woman, same thing happened to her at a New York nursing home. And she was later discovered to be alive by the funeral home staff as they were getting her ready. Dude, you always got to double check that stuff. Double tap, man. Now you can see why they put them bells on them graves, right? Good night. Kiwis, like the fruit, not the people, can boost your mood in just 4 days. Really? So apparently you can enhance your mood, energy, and overall well-being by eating kiwis, kiwi fruit. It's a potent mood enhancer. And it has vitamin C and all this other good stuff. Blah, 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 blah. Does it make you less cynical? Because right now my cynicism is like on a scale of 1 to 10, it's 51.
Nothing for that.
Yeah, but like I feel, you know, if I eat some kiwi, will it maybe help my RBF?
You'd have to eat
Do
a lot
you
of kiwi.
Suffer from RBF?
Eat a lot of kiwi.
Just 5 kiwi fruits a day will help your RBF. Do you guys know what RBF is out there in Radioland? Resting bee face. I have it naturally. It's just, I'm blessed. Hashtag blessed. I have it naturally. So I have to constantly like, that's why as I get old, I can never freeze my face. I can never do that because if I don't like look like I'm, then people, if I don't put my eyebrows up and be overly expressive, people think I'm in a horrible mood all the time. So I can never do that. Anyway, long story short, kiwis help your mood. Let's see. Ooh, Adderall, ADHD, other medication, the shortages continue. People say it's a horrible, perfect storm. Is it a blessing or a curse? I do think some people that have ADHD, I do think like kids, I think it's overprescribed. In some instances, it's helpful, but maybe it's a silver lining. I don't know. We got a lot more in the Haiti rum industry. I got to hit that later. Stick with us.
Thanks to the Inflation Reduction Act, which every single Republican member of Congress voted against, we took on Big Pharma, and we won.
Took on Big Pharma? What? Took on Big Pharma? This is the only time I can play that Kenny Chesney song. Welcome back to the program. Dana Lash here with you. Karine Jean-Pierre went to war with Big Pharma. Jolly Green Giant still repping Big Pharma? Paul Bunyan was the rep. May he rest in peace. And I think it was Jolly Green Giant. Ho, ho, ho. Right? But they told him he couldn't say ho, ho, ho anymore because it was like insensitive to like promiscuous ladies. So Big Pharma. Maybe she's actually talking about a large farmer. Maybe they just, had a little dust up. I don't know. Who the hell knows? Can we play her hits here? Because she said some things in the past, KJP, where she might be talking about a large farming person. I don't know. Kane, what's some of the other stuff she said? Remember?
Just so you know, this montage was created nearly a year ago. So it just gives you an idea of how long she's been mispronouncing things.
We're going to try to see if we can get through this without an interruption.
Yeah, listen to all of this.
Emeritus Benedict XVI.
Emeritus. Stop. Wait. She meant emeritus, but emeritus sounds like a nasty foot disease. Oh, what's wrong with you? It's my emeritus. It's just
an antibiotic for that.
Yeah. Okay, go ahead. Sorry.
Bicarmel bipartisan support. Dr. John.
So bicarmel, does that mean two separate types of caramels?
Yes.
Not by caramel. By caramel. By caramel. That's a fancy way to say caramel. Okay, go on.
On Clauser, who won the Nobel Prize in physics.
Nobel Prize. You know, it is, Kane, we were talking about this. The Nobel Prize is respectable. It's a respectable, noble prize. Goes to
say otherwise is just denying science.
Yeah, I mean, it goes to noble people win the prize, right? I mean, it is, you know, it's real, R-I-L-L. It is real respectable. The Nobel Prize is, you know, it's noble. It is noble. It is esteemed. It is respected. You know, it's real noble. Go ahead. Mm.
Sciences. Okay, the vice president will visit the DMZ. Nearly 70 years since the
Korean armistice. That sounds like a jeans store. It's the demilitarized zone. Okay, go ahead.
The visit using energy, they're weaponizing energy, and it's choosing to one of the things that has been out there, the shutdown, the pipeline of Nord Stream 1, instead of risking their lives
Of humans. Now, this is when I'm really going to object, because Nord Stream has some great sales. And now when you shut down the pipeline of those sales, like they have real good sales going on right now. When you shut down that Nord Stream sale, leave the Nord Stream sale pipeline alone. I want the pipeline of sales.
Screwing up their supply chain.
I'm telling you, like, they got some great deals right now on, like, some out-of-season stuff. Like, you can get some stuff up to, like, 70% off. They're not advertising on the show, but hell, they ought to after this point. I mean, the Nord Stream pipeline? If I had a Nord Stream pipeline, like, if that, can you imagine? Like, right to your house. Go ahead, sorry.
Human strugglers.
Human strugglers.
Human. Not smugglers. They're not human smugglers. They're human strugglers.
Like they're like aliens? Like struggling to be human?
No, I think they said there's human strugglers.
Like struggling humans?
Yeah.
Well, some days I struggle. Am I a human struggler?
Federally illegal to struggle humans.
What is a struggler? Like, is there any other type of human? Like a lizard struggler? Like that lizard is struggling. Or, you know, look at that. Rhinoceros, that's a struggling right now. It's a rhinoceros struggler. It's just struggling really badly. It's a drought or something. I don't know, right? Big farmer. We went out into the fields and we beat their ass. No, I mean, I'm just big farmer.
House Intelligence Chair speaking out about a imminent, or he doesn't say imminent, serious national security threat. The lack of your ability to say anything has the potential to raise distress for some Americans. In the simplest of terms, can you tell Americans that there's nothing they have to worry about right now in terms of what he describes as a national security threat?
Look, I think in a way that question is impossible to answer with a straight yes, right? Because Americans understand that there are a range of threats and challenges in the world that we're dealing with every single day. And those threats and challenges range from terrorism to state actors. And we have to contend with them, and we have to contend with them in a way where we ensure the ultimate security of the American people. I am confident that President Biden, in the decisions that he is taking, is going to ensure the security of the American people going forward. And I will stand here at this podium and assert that, look you in the eye with confidence, that we believe that we can and will and are protecting the national security of the United States and the American people.
So there's a lot of information coming out about this now, and this had to do with this. I think it's kind of a dramatic and hysterical way to present all this, if I'm being honest. First off, welcome back to the program. Dana Lash here with you, bottom of this second hour. And you can listen coast to coast. You can stream the radio program. You can watch the video component. I'm wearing another color other than black today. I'm wearing red. Even though I'm not a big Valentine's Day person, I'm wearing red for Valentine's Day. There you go. So there, you check that off the box. But good to be with you. Listen coast to coast, channel 347, DirecTV, the chat at YouTube. Also find us at Facebook as well, and Substack, Chapter and Verse. So let me just give you some of the latest on this, because we played for you the Jake Sullivan soundbite, and this all started with a statement that came from the House Intelligence Committee's Chairman Mike Turner, who had said that it was warning of some kind of information they needed to make available and declassify information relating to a serious national security threat, et cetera. Apparently, there's a briefing that's taking place here shortly for members of Congress about this. And then it came out that, I mean, because my first thought was, is this a way to push Ukraine funding? Then it came out, CNN reports that the national security threat is a highly concerning and is a highly concerning and destabilizing Russian capability. What? And so then this comes from Jackie Heinrich literally 3 minutes ago. A source says that material Turner is asking the Biden administration to classify deals with concerning Russian capability. The seriousness of the threat is grave, but the threat is not immediate in nature. Is this when he was talking about the hypersonic missiles in the Tucker interview? And was that his intention? Putin's intention?
Was it his intention to then
try to freak out the U.S.
because he knew about the spending stuff coming up? I don't know. Maybe, I guess.
This is why, see, don't make fun of me, everybody, for always being a cynic and suspicious. Right. Now it makes sense, doesn't it? Yeah, it's like stepping back from the wall and figuring out that Kaiser Sose was the name of some porcelain cups, right? Uh-huh. Uh-huh, usual suspects. Now it makes sense. Now it makes sense. You can't treat me like I'm Charlie Day anymore. No, now it makes sense. You step away from the wall and you're like, I'll be damned, Kaiser Sose. See? That's a great movie, except Kevin Spacey's a weirdo. Anyway, is that, I'm just wondering, it could, Occam's razor. Remember when he had that conversation in the interview, and I watched the full interview with Tucker that he did. And I don't think Tucker got rolled, but I felt like there was for no reason is Putin, for no reason other than something advantageous, is Putin going to sit down with someone and have a conversation? Right. I want to put on the table this thought too. We live in an unprecedented time where we justifiably, by the way, and keep in mind, this is in our American DNA, to always have a somewhat civil but antagonistic relationship with our government, right? That's the nature of our DNA. We don't trust our government. That's why we have our republic formed the way it is. And we are in an unprecedented time because we distrust our government, and not for no good reason, by the way. I mean, this is a government, I'm not even getting into the pandemic, that's the whole thing by itself that justifies your distrust. But the administration pressing on social media companies to censor you if they dislike your speech, the government running guns to Mexican cartels through the Fast and Furious program that lawmakers then tried to cite and craft legislation around as a way to disarm you. There are a lot of things out there, people losing their jobs because they didn't use someone's make-believe pronouns. There's a lot out there, a lot of justification to distrust your government. If I were an entity or a geopolitical opponent that sought to further destabilize my enemy or frenemy or opponent, one of the most cost-efficient, easiest, and effective ways to do that is to have them take themselves out with division, etc. That's why I do believe, and I believe that the left wants to divide the right, and I think that there are greater forces internationally, there are other forces internationally that want to divide the U.S. And that's why I think a lot of the, I think there's a lot of bots on social media that are Russian-backed, Chinese-backed. I would bet everything on that. That's a fact. And the left, in their stupidity, because they want to divide the right, they played along with that for a while. And you see what's become of it. But that is to get the, your, I mean, that's very Sun Tzu, to have your enemy defeat itself without you ever having to fire a single shot. It's the most cost efficient and it's the most effective. Because when you can take an opponent and you can corrupt it and pervert the principle of it, that is more effective than steamrolling them over. If you wage war on someone in the traditional way, the very symmetrical way that we have previously, this is asymmetrical warfare stuff, the old-fashioned way, you know, if you do it, you know, the red coat way, so to speak, you just create resentment. And you enshrine in that opponent a new generation that is going to resent you. That's one of the things that the Cold War did, is that a lot of people had, they saw a lot of the stuff that Russia was doing, and especially after Vietnam and after World War II, they saw a lot of the stuff that Russia was doing, and so they grew up with that reality. And they knew, they could name, they could enumerate reasons why they disliked Russia. I think since that time, Russia's been playing an optics battle, a narrative war. And to get the United States to turn on itself and to exploit the opportunities presented to them where they can further hammer on those differences, well, that's super successful, because you're not creating from that people who are going to be antagonistic towards them. They're going to be antagonistic towards each other. They won't view Russia as being a bad actor anymore. China hasn't yet figured out how to do that. Russia has. And my first thought did it have to do with those hypersonic missiles that Putin was talking about? I don't know. I mean, I'm speculating on that point, but you know, I am curious about this. But I do think that there are bad actors that are bots, that are China, Russia, that have tried to push people into these divisive categories. I think that they've tried to foment tension and hatred within different factions of Americans. I think that's to their advantage. They've played upon the errors of our government. They've exploited when our government has messed up and has caused distrust in the heart of its people. These bad actors, I absolutely think that they've exploited it. That's what you would do if you wanted to destabilize your opponent without using your own resources in terms of manpower or munitions. You would do that. It's one of the easiest, most cost-efficient ways to destabilize somebody. So in some ways, I think that Tucker interview was interesting. But in other ways, I wondered what persuaded Putin to do this. He's not going to sit down and talk to him unless it is completely advantageous to him. Now, keep in mind, I'm not saying that you shouldn't go and interview world leaders. I do think that you should have a journal. You have to have a journalistic enterprise. And I do think that you need to be able to talk to these individuals and interview them and ask questions. There is a difference there. But I think part of that also means that you have to weigh in what they think they're going to get out of it from you. And I don't think that that was necessarily discussed enough. So I'm sure we'll probably have a press conference about this at some point. The House members have to be briefed first. And I know that there's a briefing, I think it's actually now, that with Turner and intelligence subcommittee, this intelligence committee. But I don't know, I'm just telling you, I also saw this as well, and I keep seeing this. Hang on, let me pull this up. I keep seeing stuff like this pushed. Where they have, for instance, who's this guy? There are some people on the right, and these are the people who they're usually, they do white papers at these think tank security firms, etc. And there's one guy out there, there's several actually, who are writing these papers on how we need to reintroduce national military service, and that should be a top priority across the West. And the current model of all volunteer forces in NATO countries is no longer sustainable. Well, there's a reason why it's not sustainable. First off, you're not going to encourage people to enlist when you're forcing jabs upon them that have serious consequences, number one. Number two, you're not going to enforce people to take seriously military service when you yourself don't take it seriously. And by not taking it seriously, I mean by entertaining the fantasies of guys who think that they're women and think it's appropriate as military officers to wear high heels and makeup to work. You're not going to get people to enlist when you're preaching about CRT and DEI. You're not going to get people to enlist when you have folks like Lloyd Austin at the top who thinks that they can surreptitiously go to the hospital and not even inform their deputy of what's happening. You're not going to get people to enlist when they don't trust their country, when they don't trust their government. You're not going to get people to enlist when their government tells them that they themselves are the bigger enemy here. You're not going to get people to enlist when they see their government jailing people for unlawful parading or people who went into the Capitol and didn't do any damage of getting more jail time than child predators in California. You're not going to get people to enlist when they are being taxed to death and watching their billions of dollars go to Ukraine. And you're sure as hell not going to get people to enlist when your military bureaucracy hasn't won a conflict in how long? When you have not been able for 30 years to identify a clear objective for any kind of military involvement? When you play politics with the lives of our young men and women and you send them overseas for what? Popularity contests with foreign nations? When there's no clear objective, when rules of engagement set entire teams up to get killed? When you take political correctness more seriously than the objective or the lives of the people carrying out these missions? No, you are not going to get enlistment, and you do not solve that by requiring anti-American communist mandatory military service. You want to see people out into the streets raising all kinds of hell? It will make BLM look like nothing. That's a promise. Take it however you want to, and blink the CIA. We got more on the way as we get moving. And we got Florida Man coming up too. Our partners.
It's his life mission to make bad decisions. It's time for Florida Man.
I got to go. I got to start with this Florida man calling 911. I can't. I get it. I don't know. Maybe it's like we've all been conditioned by online reviews and Yelp and everything else to think that we got to complain or we should give feedback for every single experience that we have. Because that's exactly what this guy, that's the only thing I can use. That's the only way I can explain this. A Florida man called 911 during his arrest to complain about the officers arresting him, according to the affidavit. Yeah, he made a scene in a Wawa over a handicap spot, and then he called 911 because the officers were trying to take him into custody, and they were, like, threatening him, like, you better stop this, or we're going to have to arrest you. So he called 911 and went off about him. 39-year-old Nicholas Taylor was charged with disorderly intoxication and misuse of 911 after he raised a fit up at the Wawa. He came across a vehicle in the handicap spot without a permit. He stormed into the store and caused a scene and then threatened to fight the person who parked there and was screaming at him, do you want to fight? Do you want to fight? According to the police. And then he stood behind the vehicle and wouldn't let them leave. And he kept trying to fight the guy. Law enforcement arrived. They told him to stop. They said they could smell the liquor on him from halfway across the lot. And he was argumentative. And then he demanded a sergeant respond. And then when the officers were like, we're going to have to take you in, buddy, he called 911 to complain about the officers. He was taken to Lake County Jail, and he posted $1,500 bond. Like, you know, don't. Maybe just don't. A Florida man ate raw chicken for 25 straight days in a bizarre dietary experiment. What? No one knows why he's not dead. What? Also, that's nasty.
He's still alive?
He's alive. This guy said that he was eating raw chicken. He was on, it's on, he's on Instagram. It was the raw chicken experiment. This is.
Let me try that tonight then. See, it's
shut
not bad. I guess
up.
It's not that bad.
Shut up, Kane. No, you're not doing this. This is so weird.
He didn't die. He didn't die.
But did you die? No, we're not doing this. That's so gross. Like, why? He said it reminded him of a scallop. That's nasty. No, we don't. Mm-mm. We got more on the way. Stick with us. Third hour coming up. Here's how I look at things. And my husband says I have the worst attitude ever on this stuff. I said, you know what? Just expect that you're going to get disappointed by somebody. People got to realize that this is about business of the country, not friends of the country. I don't care if someone's nice. What do you get me in terms of reduced taxpayer dollars going to foreign nations over foreign conflicts? What do you get me in terms of a secure border? What do you get me in keeping your government Uncle Sam hands out of my pockets?
The Dana Show.
And anybody that thinks that Putin's not serious about those threats need to look a little closer at what he's been saying. Not just this Tucker Carlson interview. Look at his speeches. Look at his writings over recent years. He absolutely bristles at NATO on his border. He absolutely bristles at the idea that NATO could be stronger and more relevant, which it is right now. And he has threatened some of our NATO allies. So we got to take this seriously, because I tell you, if you think it costs a lot right now to support Ukraine, think about the costs to American blood and treasure if, in fact, he goes after a NATO ally. And then you got American troops on the ground involved in combat.
This is just, no. This is ridiculous. This is John Kirby. Basically, I mean, now it's, you know, well, if you want a strong border, you support Putin. Or if you don't support this now, then, I mean, you know, we're going to have boots on the ground and it's going to get super expensive. That's ultimately what they're saying here. If you think it's a lot now, why would we have troops on the ground involved in combat in Ukraine? They're not a NATO member. They're not an ally. Why in the ever-loving hell would we have boots on the ground? Stop fear-mongering, War Inc. Welcome back to the program. Dana Lash here with you. Top of this third hour of the program. Why would we have boots on the ground? There is no reason. And the idea that I hear people say that he bristles, that Putin bristles, or he's mad about having NATO on his borders. He's had NATO on his borders for flipping ever. Estonia and Latvia. Do people know where those are on the map? Do they know? The Baltic states? Do they know? They've been NATO members for quite a long time. They're on the border. Finland was just added in April of last year, and that's the most eastward extending country. So, I haven't seen any threats. I feel like this is War Inc. trying to go back to Cold War days. Now, I wanted to, again, you can listen to the program coast to coast, stream it. You can find the video simulcast on channel 347 DirecTV. You can also find the chat on YouTube, also on Facebook, find some video. I wanted to bring this up. This was U.S. defense officials. So while we were on break, U.S. defense officials confirmed that the national security threat has to do with a new space-based capability by the Russian military. Huh. Wow, it's so wild that it just comes out that there's this crazy space threat as this Ukraine supplemental bill of $61 billion to Ukraine that it's stalling out. Wow. So shocking that we just now find this. Yeah. Wow. This is all to push this. Every bit of it's to push the spending bill. Wow. I mean, I got a lot of, we got to have $95 billion to neutralize the threat in space. Right? Isn't that what it sounds like? That's what it sounds like they're pushing. I don't trust the people telling us that this is a national security threat. Especially somebody like Jake Sullivan, who was involved in the dossier stuff. I mean, good grief. Let me pull this up. This guy was one of the people who told everybody that the laptop story was a Russian, was just a Russian oppo. And it wasn't, but that's what he said. This is a guy who helped push the dossier. I don't believe people who've lied to me. I don't believe this is a national security threat. I don't. I mean, this was a guy who had tried to co-opt the CIA and FBI in 2016. Jake Sullivan, he was a senior foreign policy advisor to Hillary Clinton. He did the project. He spearheaded the whole thing to try to link Trump to the Kremlin through fabricated email server records. Remember all of this? That all came out in the testimony that Michael Sussman, who is a partner in the law firm that Hillary Clinton used as her agent, her transactional agent, to hide her direct involvement of retaining Fusion GPS. It was Perkins Coie, the law firm that her campaign used. And Sussman is a partner at Perkins Coie, and he was the one who represented her and all that. He had been indicted because for lying to the FBI about this stuff. And this, it all came out, Sullivan's involvement all came out in this. They said of the people who were involved in the conspiracy to mislead the FBI and trigger an investigation included Jake Sullivan. NSA Jake Sullivan. The Jake Sullivan now that's on stage telling you that there's an immediate security threat. Just so happens they're telling you this when the $95 billion bill to send our money to Ukraine is stalling out. And I'm sorry, but I think that the dude, I think this Turner dude's a rhino. Remember, these were the guys who fabricated all of the stuff about the server thing, linking Trump to Kremlin, the Alpha Bank story that the New York Times wrote and then had to very surreptitiously, you know, kind of retract. All of that. That's all these guys. This is all of them. And Jake Sullivan, they coordinated all to provide this fake, these fake materials to the FBI, Mark Elias, everybody. This is the guy now telling you that there's a huge threat, trying to scare you into parting with billions of dollars. Why do they want this money so damn bad then? Thoughts, Kane? Why do they want it so bad? This is wild. So that's who's telling you that this is a national security threat. I don't, and then, oh, I can't answer with a straight yes. Jake Sullivan couldn't answer with a straight anything. I don't believe any of this. Oh, it's a security threat related to, why didn't they come out and just say, oh, it's about Russia's space? That's what it's about. That's what it's about. I'm sure this doesn't have anything to do with the prolonging everything going down in Ukraine and et cetera. Wow. So this is right after that interview with Putin, too. And after, I'm full of conspiracy theories right now. Yeah. You are, too?
I am, too.
Kane and I are sitting over there both going,
I mean, there's so many things wrong with this. Like, so many things wrong.
I don't believe in coincidences in politics.
So are they saying then the money that they need, that they want the House to pass for Ukraine, is going to go to space?
No, they haven't said that yet. They're just trying to say there's a threat. And then it'll probably come out later that, well, maybe we should pass this bill to help with this threat.
Yeah, I see it. It's a slow walk to the narrative.
Yeah.
Because they don't want to be too obvious. They don't want to come out the day that they're voting on the stuff and say, hey, Ukraine. Now that I
like, you had a reporter ask Jake Sullivan, quote, can you tell Americans there's nothing they have to worry about right now in terms of what is described as a national security threat? And Sullivan said, quote, that question is impossible to answer with a straight S. You rat bastard. Out here fear mongering people. You distrustful little weasel out here fear mongering people to push this $95 billion supplemental. That's what this is. There's no threat. I don't believe the people telling me there is, because they've lied about everything. Why would I start believing them now? They've been lying to you since before 2016. The same people who tried to rob you. The coup was what people like Jake Sullivan and everyone else tried to do in 2016. And rob people of a free and fair election. That was the attempted coup. They needed the right to do something so they could get the attention off themselves. That's why they blew J6 up so crazy. That was the attempted coup. Literally fabricating information and working with the Kremlin. This is indisputable. It's a fact. Laundering lies through the press. Paid for, and then using the stories that produced and handing it to the FISA court and saying, look at this, this is evidence. They laundered it like a cartel would through the press So then they could say that this isn't from us. This is their own independent reporting that we gave them. And all these journalists out here with no spine that ran this stuff like it was their own work. I don't have a lot of respect for, and there's some conservative websites that do this, that will take oppo from politicians and run it as a byline. I don't like that. And that's what this was. $95 billion. So now they got to try to say, oh, guys, something spooky. There's some spookiness happening here. Got to pass this $95 billion. And the guy who was right, the coordinator of all the Russian dossier stuff up there pushing this on you. And people wonder why we don't trust our government. You wonder why. So the Senate passes it. And the House, I told you, they're going to bring the thunder down on the House any way they can. And this is it. This is part of it. This is part of it. It's unbelievable. So hopefully, I mean, Johnson needs to hold the line on here. I mean, they were successful and they impeached Mayorkas. He's not going to be removed from office, but they were successful and they at least got that to happen. So that was good. But this, it's not space aliens. I was kind of hoping it was space aliens, Kane.
It still may change to that.
I mean, I'm still not going to give $95 billion. I mean, you could have, there's this alien show that I'm watching. I can't remember what it's called. It's like an alien drama. Can't remember.
What, old one? A new
one? No, it's a new one. It's episodic. I can't think of the name of it. Anyway, it's about, you know, aliens that come in and some, you know, we figured out how to uncloak their ships and all this stuff. And the alien design is actually pretty interesting. And it has these different groups that are in their own ways working to help defeat, you know, the aliens, etc. You would have to get to that point before I would consider spending $95 billion. And it still wouldn't be sending it over to Ukraine. It would be on us. So, there you go. This makes me angry. It makes me angry that anybody's pushing this, that you have a Republican that came out with a statement. It makes me angry that you have Jake Sullivan up there. It makes me angry that they're playing around. They think that national security is something that can be leveraged to push spending. This is about laundering money through Ukraine. You're talking about spending $61 billion on Ukraine. There's no objective. There's no end in sight. They can't even say what their mission would be. And then in another almost $10 billion to the terrorists and Hamas. Seriously? And I reject everyone as unserious. The people who say, oh, no, it goes to the Gazan people. It goes to the Gazan health ministry. Who runs the Gazan health ministry? You cousin-loving morons. Who? It's Hamas. The same people that work with the UN to have a tunnel under the UN's HQ there in Gaza. No. We have more on the way. We got headlines coming up. Our partners that help. Committing to a healthier diet this year seemed like a straightforward resolution, but actually doing it, that's way more challenging. Better nutrition is a key to health and longevity. So this year, get into a new healthy habit with Field of Greens. Field of Greens is nutrition the way nature intended it. Each superfruit and vegetable in Field of Greens was doctor selected to support vital organs such as the heart, lungs, and kidneys, as well as promoting a healthy metabolism for sustaining energy and weight management. Field of Greens is an organic superfood rich in antioxidants, fiber, and prebiotics formulated to enhance overall well-being. People taking Field of Greens have noticed more energy throughout the day, healthier looking skin, and improved digestion. You'll notice better health or your money back. If you resolve to get healthier in 24, it starts with Field of Greens. Visit fieldofgreens.com and use promo code Dana to get 15% off your first order and free rush shipping. That's promo code Dana at fieldofgreens.com.
And now, all of the news you would probably miss. It's time for Dana's Quick Five.
Haiti's rum industry has taken a hit as gangs are torching sugarcane fields. They're the newest victim of violent gangs trying to control a number of businesses and territory in Haiti. Their renowned rum, the latest victim of violent gangs. They're all trying to control this stuff. It's all turf war. They said that about 19, almost 20 acres of sugarcane fields were torched in recent days as rival gangs were fighting near a distillery near Port-au-Prince. And they said that the lost fields are not going to affect production, but they said that they're going to have to stop distributing free potable water and doing some other things because they have to protect the safety of their employees at this point. And this is one of the country's most popular exports as well. So leave the rum alone. Like, for, you know, you're an enemy of all humanity if you're doing this, not just of like a rival gang, but you're literally an enemy of all things good if you're burning sugarcane fields for rum. Let's see. A plane carrying Canadian skydivers hit the beach in southern Mexico, killing a guy on the ground. This is crazy. So four Canadian skydivers came down on a beach Sunday in southern Mexico. One guy who was on the beach was killed. There was no information about what made the plane go down, but it looks like it made a forced landing, and the plane was largely intact. But it fell in a pretty populated section. That's horrific. Four Canadians, one Mexican man removed from the plane, taken for treatment. Their state civil defense said they were in stable condition. Goodness. Let's see. A gang stole 145 tons of chicken in a bizarre heist of up to 55,000 birds. This is 1,660 boxes full of poultry, and they risked 20 years in prison for their crimes. This was in Havana.
290,000 pounds of chicken.
Well, they were peddling the stolen goods on the street, trying to buy. If they were like feeding the poor, that would be one thing, but they were selling them so that they could buy watches. But here's the other thing, though. Listen to how this is written. They said watches and other luxury items like refrigerators and air conditioners. That seems kind of like a necessity and not a luxury item, though. I don't think that the person who wrote this article understands what luxury item is. And they said that the video surveillance, they caught all of it. So we have more on the way, including how you're being manipulated to prolong the conflict in Ukraine. Stick with me.
Craving a daily dose of intellectual adrenaline? Look no further than the Dana Show podcast, where curiosity meets courage, by following on Apple, Spotify, or wherever you get your podcasts.
Amendments that are being considered, one of them would require a warrant for every query of lawfully collected data. If that were to pass and get into the bill, would the president veto that bill?
So I'm not in a position to stand here today and make veto threats on behalf of the president. Those are decisions for him to make. What I will tell you is that we do not believe that that serves the national security interests of the United States. And in fact, today I will be making that case to a number of members that the warrant requirement as conceived is not the best way actually to ensure the protection of the personal privacy of Americans. There are a number of other elements of the bill that we have supported that would reform and update FISA to protect the civil liberties of Americans. But a warrant requirement from our perspective would go too far in undermining the very purpose of FISA. Frankly, it would put victims at risk.
What? So if we have a warrant and we respect due process, then Kane, are you okay with that? Welcome back to the program. Dana here. I'm checking on Kane. Kane.
No, I'm okay.
Kane
physically,
froze and he made...
Physically, I'm all right. Mentally, it was...
Your eyes went to googly mode.
Yeah. I don't understand. So the whole requiring a warrant by authorities is not helpful to Americans? I think it's more not helpful to authorities, I think is basically what he's getting at.
Who, Kane, are Americans, you know?
That is quite an argument you make.
I mean, those authorities are Americans.
Right.
So... it's not helpful to them.
The ones in position of authority are, yeah, American, but more accountable to Americans than the average American.
Yeah, I see what you're saying there, Kane, but I'm just not free to speak on the accountability. But they are Americans, yes, and, having just dispersing with the whole warrant requirement. You know, makes it easy for those Americans to go after those other Americans. You know, I just drop on Jake Sullivan here, just drop on my own history as a grunt for Hillary Clinton, you know, going and working with the crowd. I mean, honestly, maybe that's what he thinks. He thinks that, you know, it's the only thing I get. Goodness. This is just, they're going to be arguing over this tomorrow on the floor. It goes to the floor. Tomorrow, the whole FISA 702 program that's scheduled, Reforming Intelligence and Securing America Act. It's coming up on the floor tomorrow.
Securing America Act, that sounds like it's important.
Yeah, like securing America seems important. Yeah. Securing America at the expense of Americans' liberty, though. Yeah. Franklin said that if you think that you can have... What is it? Security to protect peace? You deserve neither.
If you give up, yeah,
give
liberty.
Up. If you give up liberty to secure peace, you deserve neither. Exactly. So, now we've been talking about the breaking news that came out while we were on air about how there's like now a space threat or something. They're pushing this. They're pushing this as a way to manipulate you into voting. Or to have your lawmakers vote for this ridiculous bill that's, I mean, again, tons of taxpayer dollars towards Ukraine. And they're saying, oh, it's a very concerning, very destabilizing threat. I like how they're just dripping it out. They could have said that from the beginning, but that doesn't scare people for an hour. You know, it doesn't scare them enough for like an hour or so. But they say it's a breakthrough with Russia's space technology. Very convenient, you know, right after this bill stalls out in the House and, you know, all of these others. It's just so convenient. Just, I'm sure it's just, you know, I'm sure that it's just a shocker. Here's this Department of Defense statement that came out this morning. It's the Missile Defense Agency. Space Development Agency announced the upcoming launch of 6 satellites into low orbit Earth from Space Launch Complex 40 in Cape Canaveral. It includes 2 satellites for MDA's hypersonic and ballistic tracking space sensor and the final 4 SDA tranche tracking the layer satellites of its proliferated warfighter space architecture as part of the National Security Space Launch Program. And then you have SpaceX's Falcon 9 that's delivering the satellites to orbit. Maybe we should put Elon Musk on this.
Yeah.
I mean, just saying. Howard Hughes served his country. Just saying. Maybe some we could put. Howard Hughes came in clutch on for something during World War II. Maybe this is something here. This is something maybe Musk could deal with. I'm just saying, it's all the timing on this. It's all so interesting.
Exactly. That story that you just talked about came out at the exact same time that Mike Turner put out that notice wanting Biden to declassify information because of this threat. So it seems coordinated in some way. This is about space. What Mike Turner's talking about is about space.
Mm-hmm.
This is all about money. This is literally what it is. It's all about money.
So see, Kane, in order to secure America's space or space for America or American air, whatever,
right?
We have to send $61 billion to Ukraine.
Yeah. I guess that's where I'm having
see, it's this. It's the same principle as putting a bunch of cash on a pallet and sending it up to the sun to combat the global warming. That's what it...
It would block some of the sun rays for a little bit, though.
Yeah, you paper over them with the money.
Right.
That's why it's very important to throw money at these things. So see, what they're going to do in Ukraine is they're going to take our $61 billion and just paper over and suffocate the Russian advance with it.
Well, they'll take our $61 billion. And they'll just throw it into space. That's what they'll do.
Yeah, like they're in the champagne room.
Making it rain.
Yeah, yeah. Like literally. Just, you know, dollar bills, y'all. That's what they're gonna go up and do. And then Russians are gonna go, oh my goodness, look, they're making it rain in space. We cannot take on the Americans. That's what they'll do. And then they'll just some conspiracy theorist out there is gonna say my Russian accent's too good. I could have been a spy. I can have any accent except a Texas accent. I cannot do a Texas accent to save my life. It's weird. It's like a normal speaking voice, and then all of a sudden there's a drowl out of nowhere. Like it comes and it hits you in the face, and you're like, "Whoa, Texas!" That's what it's like. Anyway, so the they're going to have a briefing. I've been asking some members of Congress, like, what's up? Is it space aliens? I really wish it was. It's not anything that interesting. I mean, I just think if you're going to freak us all out, like, make it good. Otherwise, you're just going to be the boy who cried wolf, and we're not going to take you seriously, especially when you send out a bumbling weasel liar like Jake Sullivan, that Kremlin-loving grifter. When you send somebody like that out just to peddle this stuff, definitely not going to believe you. But I just, you know, I just kind of feel like, It would have been way cooler if it was space aliens. Like, guys, we got to... Think about it. Where would you have been tempted to say, maybe we can spend some money on some of... I would still say on our own defense, if it was a giant, you know, space alien ship in the sky getting ready to kill us all. I don't know. I just feel like that would be more... And this is Russia. They couldn't even steamroll through Ukraine. You think they're going to go up in space and try to get froggy? Golly, War Inc., the fantasies that these people have. Oh, man. So the brief, the information, any developments on that we'll have for you and make sure that we'll share that with you. But in the meantime, don't be manipulated into thinking this. I mean, I just, and the warrantless searches too. It does seem like it's kind of tying all of this together. Oh my gosh, we got to have these warrantless searches. It's very important to our security.
Yeah.
Oh, by the way, here's a risk to our security, but I'm not in a position to tell you about it. And then we have to wait for the slow drip from members of the press who go, "Oh, well, it has to do with space and Russians. Russians in space and capabilities." Yeah, that.
I think the slow drip that you talked about is an effort to probably, I mean, they know they're getting nowhere with this bill, and it's an effort to push this into the weekend, into a weekend news cycle, and have some sort of crazy event between now and
wait,
the
what
weekend.
Do you mean crazy event?
I don't know. Something else that motivates, quote unquote, people to vote yay on the funding.
I am not going to be motivated by anything to be yay on the funding. It's just not ever going to happen.
We'll see what happens. That's, I got a tinfoil hat. I get it. But we'll see what happens.
There is not anything that is going to make me do it that I would be in support of it. Nothing. I'm not sending $10 billion to Gaza. It's not going to happen. Not going to happen for Hamas to go and buy more rockets. Not going to happen. Not sending another $61 billion to Ukraine. Not going to happen. There is no threat that they could use to prevail upon me. The need that convinced me to do this. It's just not going to I'm not going to support it. It's just stupid. You know, I think the security threat is the people that we don't know coming across the southern border. That's the security threat.
And if Republicans were smart, they'd be running on this issue and pointing to the fact that here's the number of illegal entries on the year before Biden actually took over. And now here in succession, these 3+ years that Biden's been in charge and taking away a lot of those protections at the border, here are the numbers now. It's clear.
If they were smart, and if, I don't like engaging in hypotheticals, you know, but I would say if my aunt had beans, she'd be my uncle. But if, you know, they were smart, they would be out there saying, yes, we agree there is a national security threat. We don't know who's coming across the southern border. Here's one terrorist that was known, that was apprehended and released. Here's another terrorist that was known, who was briefly detained and then released. Here's another terrorist, and like throw all that stuff up. That's what they should be doing. They should immediately be going out and hammering this. If only there was an organization that like could help the Republicans with messaging and oh my goodness, I don't even know. By the way, Lorraine has a great piece up about Trump needs to not be able to pick the RNC head because his choices are bad. And she makes a really good explainer for it. You're going to be able to access that here momentarily up at Substack. It's a good piece and you need to read it and you need to share it because he shouldn't. And then, especially after the New York thing, because he helped flip that seat. You can get mad at me for saying it, but I mean, a third of the people who went out and voted, and this was a seat that was Republican. It's a +7 Democrat district. They went +2 to Santos, and then the Democrat took it +5. A third of the voters said the most important issue was stopping Trump, and 27% said they were concerned about threats to democracy. Oh, my gosh. But they hate Biden. It's like, who do you hate more? People are hate voting. You have to. I don't care if you agree with them or not. Your job as a liberty evangelist is to figure out how to message those people to get the vote the way you want them to. You're going to have to work with that. That's what you got to work with. Getting mad and taking your ball and going home because they don't like your guy isn't the way to do it. That's how you lose. You got to figure out how to work with that and persuade people. Oh my gosh. All right. We got to get moving this Valentine's Day. Valentine's Day is, I think, goofy. Don't feel bad if you're not doing anything for Valentine's Day. Cause I normally don't do it, especially after Parkland, which took place 6 years ago, a horrific tragedy. I definitely haven't done anything on Valentine's Day. But it's such a commercialized thing. It really is. But I'm wearing red today. So don't send me any more hate mail. There's three of you who do. Three. It's a whole three people, but it's like every week. Don't you have anything other than black? Actually, no, I don't. Like my whole closet is just one solid color. It's a gradient of black.
It's probably just one person acting like they're three people.
Maybe. But I'm like, I get so many nice emails, but those are the ones that I hear. I'm like, stop it. So I'm wearing red today. Anyway, we got to get moving. And as we do so.
Follow Dana on Apple, Spotify, or wherever you get your podcasts, because knowledge is your ultimate superpower.
Our thoughts are with the families of the three students who were tragically killed 1 year ago at Michigan State University, the five students who were injured as a result of this horrific gun violence, and the countless others traumatized by that day. Tomorrow also marks another painful tragedy as we remember the 14 students and three educators who lost their lives 6 years ago at Marjorie Stoneman Douglas High School in Parkland, Florida.
Someone give her
from Michigan to Florida, lessons, American children and educators are being gunned down in classrooms, on college campuses,
she
and in their
make
own
any
home
mention
and communities
of the lives
as guns
saved in Sutherland Springs.
Nor
does she
killer.
Mention that it's not an issue of quote unquote gun violence. It's an issue of people who could have done something not doing anything. When you have over 48 calls to the police from the neighbors of the killer that was in Parkland. Let me just tell you something about Parkland. That could have been prevented easily without due process eroding red flag laws or anything else. The student was so violent, he had to have a minder in school before he dropped out because he couldn't be trusted to attend classes by himself without being violent. He had two times held a gun to other kids' heads. He knocked his own mother's teeth out. He had made so many threats, it's crazy. It would have been easy to have rendered him ineligible through the current legal pathways. It would have been easy for the police to have intervened. And that shameful scumbag, Scott Israel, never did. And he had the audacity to blame me on stage at the town hall, which happened a week later. No, it's all on their hands. It's the killer and them. And Robert Runcie, who refused to listen to the Secret Service parent who did a risk assessment of the school and concluded that it was open, that it was in danger. And they didn't do anything. And that was 3 months before this massacre. Shame on her. Now, we've been following that story. I'll have updates for you on Substack chapter and verse about the space threat from Russia. But there's all kinds of stuff coming in. Always wait for things to be confirmed and all of that. And remember, you're being baited. You're being baited. Today in stupidity, Kane.
All right. It is Karine Jean-Pierre. Remember yesterday when Biden had come out, did the press conference, and wasn't taking questions and said he'd be taking questions today? Well, the reporter asked about that.
Said yesterday that he would be taking questions today or tomorrow. What was he referring to?
I don't have anything to share at this time.
Oh,
as you
don't
know,
have anything to share. So Biden just says stuff, and then, you know, the White House has nothing to share about it.
Yeah, nothing to share. Nothing to share. Of course he knew he wasn't going to come back and answer questions. Folks, that does it for us today. Happy Valentine's Day. God bless. Happy Ash Wednesday as well. I'll be back with you tomorrow.